The you know, discussion on interdisciplinarity and digital scholarship so often goes to a focus on digital humanities and fields that are not scientific, but I wanted to make sure and balance this conference with at least one prominent presentation on interdisciplinary and advanced kinds of methods from the scientific perspective. In the past, when I've done these similar kinds of symposia, I've found that I've often invited astronomers and people that you know, assemble data sets on the unimaginably large aspects of the universe. And I thought it would be very apropos and very instrumental in having somebody speak about the indescribably small. Daniel is a true interdisciplinary scholar and somebody that whose perspectives I really have come to appreciate very much in the short time I've been here at UNCG. He is the department chair of nanoscience and can speak to some really insightful approaches to interdisciplinarity in the sciences and how that bears on P&T in the 21st century in ways that I think will be very interesting. So please let me introduce Daniel here.
Thank you. So good morning. So just to do some level setting, since Martin mentioned astronomy, you may be thinking, well, what is nano? What's nanoscience? So we are to the sun what somebody living in the nano world is to us. Okay, so it's very small. So the nanoscience department is relatively new, and we are just wrapping up a revision to our P&T policy, so you'll see some of the results here. I think we're aligned now with the UNC system guidelines and UNCG guidelines, and we've also borrowed heavily from the College of Arts and Science guidelines. So I'm not going to talk about those. And focus more on those things that are really special to the nanoscience department and reflect our values. I'm going to use some opening thoughts and some background that's sort of driving our values, driving our mission statement, and how that maps into our promotion and tenure guidelines. And I'm going to do just a simple walk through the nanoscience P&T landscape with respect to education and teaching, research and service, and end with a closing thought. I'm not going to spend time on this. These are some references that were useful in helping us put together our guidelines. And you're going to record this so people can access this anytime. Okay, good. But primarily, the National Science Foundation and other government agencies have been very concerned about the United States losing its strength in STEM education and STEM careers. So most of these are based on workshops and publications coming out of those events. More recently, the National Academy back in November was also concerned about convergence education. They think that's going to be critical in the 21st century, and that report should be coming out in about a month. So I firmly believe that each one of us has very important stories to share that will impact our future. So I can begin by just thinking back, the stories and people who catalyzed your career path. Maybe that teacher, caregiver, place. Okay. I'm going to tell you one story. And when I was in third grade, I would walk home from school. And I would turn that 10-minute walk home through the woods into an hour or more adventure through the woods. And there were always these stones to pick up and bugs to look at and twigs and all sorts of magical things. And I returned to that very woods 2 years ago, and they're here. And lo and behold, over the decades, a path was created. So I started walking up that path, and you know, it just didn't seem as exciting as it was when I was a kid until I stepped off that path, and then it became magical again. And so that's I think my colleagues in the nanoscience department sort of share that quest for the magical. It reminded me of a quote from Isaac Newton on his deathbed, where he likened his life to that of a child coming upon a beach and picking up a rock. He just marveled at all the life that was under there and the structure of the rock, and And then he stood up and realized that there was an entire beach of stones still to pick up. So it was like a treasure hunt. And that's how we like to see the nano world. It's fairly new science. And so it's still in a treasure hunt mode for us. Back in the early 2000s, do you remember when there was the Columbia disaster? And then there were those Martian landers where some of them crashed due to a metric to conversion problem. At that time, NASA was challenged to completely redo their 25-year strategic plan. And I was asked to be on the nanotechnology committee. So we did the 25-year roadmap. And then we asked ourselves what might be an ultimate challenge for nanotechnology for NASA. And there were two. One was to, could we create synthetic white blood cells to accompany astronauts on long space flights so that if a precancerous tissue was forming, these augmented cells could lyse those to cancerous tissues. The other challenge we looked at were those crashes of those landers. And one of my colleagues suggested, well, what if instead of having all the risk in this 350-kilogram Phoenix lander, we created 1,350-gram landers, sort of 3/4 of a pound, and we deploy those on the Martian surface. Some of them are going to crash, but those that survived, if they could exhibit autonomous emergent behavior, well, the mission would be successful, and we can map out a much larger portion of Mars. This was the vision. We thought, that's great, but is there a proof of principle for that? And a colleague from UCLA showed this movie of a white blood cell, which is here, chasing a bacterium. These are red blood cells in your body. And what amazed me at the time was, because I was in electronics, this white blood cell that's about 10 microns across doesn't have a brain. But it has sensors, processors, and actuators, and was able to stay on track. And I think the bacteria also knows it was being challenged. And ultimately,
Got it.
So we thought, this is great. But what struck me recently is that we were involved with NASA, and it was the team was able to pivot and look at an example in a totally different discipline, biology, to justify what might be possible in terms of this NASA program. That was a very convergent and transdisciplinary approach. Oops, there we go. So for the electronics industry, I came away with, we're getting to the point where we can't shrink transistors much further, but we can add different functionality onto a computer chip. And so these were some of anything that a cell does, it exhibits complex functionality. These are all new avenues for us to go after. And the market out there, there are tremendous job opportunities, new market opportunities. The blood tests alone, by the way, if we were to use a bio-inspired approach to analyzing blood tests, that's a multi-trillion-dollar market. So other pebbles, each of the national funding agencies have their 21st century strategic priorities. National Science Foundation has their 10 big ideas, from understanding the rules of life to the future of the human technology interface and how it applies to work. Diversity, inclusion, and equity is really high on their priority list, thank goodness. Harnessing the data revolution, quantum technology, but a growing need to recognize convergence and transdisciplinary research and seeding innovation. Other agencies like DARPA and NIH also have their priorities. I'm not going to spend time on them. I left off National Endowment for Humanities, but National Endowment for the Arts, other institutions have their 21st century priorities. This is from the National Academy's 13 Grand Challenges. And the question is, can any of these challenges be solved by a single discipline? Oops. These solutions really require a collaborative effort. So I think we need to move in that direction. In fact, in electronics, we're thinking about, suppose we want to make artificial retinas. Well, the electronics folks would like to make artificial retinas out of transistors, and chips, but it's not compatible with your eye. So the key message is to leverage colleagues who know the local environment. It's very natural. So one of the things that came out of the NSF workshop back in 2014 that was that convergence and transdisciplinarity are important, but they're not sufficient. So these are, you can look at these later on, but community engaged learning was high on the priority list. Translational activities, faculty need to understand doing foundational research and teaching is our primary role, but at least be aware of how it might benefit society. Creating innovation platforms, hands-on learning. We're finding that the K through 12 kids, if you can give them some hands-on projects in the nanoscience world, it totally engages them. Science communication, I'll come back to this later on. Environmental awareness. If you create a technology, and we've seen this repeated over and over again, 20 years from now, we don't want to have to clean that up. So we need to, as we move forward, have that part of our culture. A math and critical thinking is the other one. Okay. So these are attributes of a robust STEAM environment. So most folks concentrate on STEM, and I think we need to also think about STEAM, which is just adding the arts and humanities into that equation. The plus here, okay, so I'm always in a debate with colleagues about either you're deep or you're a generalist and very broad. Today you need both. You need to be deep in an area but be able to handshake with colleagues in other disciplines. This is still background. All right, don't worry about reading this. It's just here to document. These are our mission statement in the nanoscience department. We want to provide a transdisciplinary educational experience. We want to prepare our students for careers in academia, government, and industry. We want to ensure that our programs are integrated, focusing on foundational nanoscience research. And finally, establish and encourage and advocate for strategic and synergistic academic, industry, community engagements and collaborations. That's the most ready slide I'll have today. All right, so just in terms of taxonomy, I put this up here as a disciplinary hierarchy. So on to the left, we have what we might call intradisciplinary education. As we move through to cross-disciplinary is where the disciplines are beginning to talk with each other. Interdisciplinary is where the different disciplines are actually beginning to develop a common language. They overlap considerably. And ultimately, transdisciplinary experience is where the disciplines actually have established a common language. Okay. Currently, the nanoscience department is moving. We're still in the sort of cross-disciplinary to interdisciplinary realm, but we're moving towards a transdisciplinary ecosystem. So we have up here, this is what's in our mission statement, and here are our tenure guidelines. So what does that mean for teaching? So currently, all first-year students coming into our program, it's a tough year. So imagine all first-year students have to take advanced courses in math, physics, chemistry, and biology. So you can imagine a biologist taking advanced math for the first time, or a mathematician taking advanced biology for the first time. It's tough, but what happens after that first year is over, we find that each of the students in different disciplines serve as mentors for their cohorts in the other disciplines. So it becomes a very tight group by the end of the year, and they make it through. Secondly, we like to infuse each of those core courses with a theme that runs across the courses. So it might be nanomaterials. We're now in the conversation of moving forward, and instead of having those distinct disciplinary courses, we're considering creating two courses, both of them focusing on nanoscience platforms, and then weaving through those courses the foundational disciplines of math, physics, chemistry, and biology to see how that works. Beyond that, we also recognize the need for reaching out and collaborating with our colleagues in other departments off campus. In fact, in 2015, I think you all know Alan Alda. Yeah. So January 2015, I began a conversation with Alan, and I was sharing with him the importance of bridging the different disciplines, the different departments. And we had about a 3-month correspondence at the end of which he said, you need to come to our summer institute, but bring with you colleagues from communication studies, from theater arts, and from the business school. And colleagues at the Weaver Foundation funded our going there, and it was a magical experience. We've come back, we've stayed in touch. In fact, we've started doing collaborative courses with folks in communication studies. We're using heavily the communication and writing centers on campus. And our students, the benefits are immediate. We see they're competing for things like the 2 minutes to win it competition and cleaning the clock on others. The 3 minutes to win it, the competition. They're getting out there, and probably most importantly is when we have tours at the joint school. We have K-12 classes. We may have families. We may have politicians. We may have other technical colleagues. And the students know that when I see them in the tour, then I'm going to ask them to give an elevator pitch. And they have to decide, who am I speaking with? Is it a 4-year-old? Is it the governor? How do I explain it best? So they take that as a sort of a fun challenge these days. All right, moving to research. Again, don't focus on this. The two things is, how do we effectively mentor our graduate students in the nanosciences? And how do we encourage that engagement with the community and also encourage entrepreneurial activity? At this year's strategic retreat, we tried to capture the scope of our research endeavors, and we all recognize that sustainability has become a critical part of what we do. So this is how we're sort of structured in terms of the scope of our research, and we've organized it, and this is actually Steve Smith at the South Dakota School of Mines helped us with this. These are our foundational research endeavors. These are enabling bridges, and these are more of our convergent areas. Let me go into just 2 examples. I'm going to give you 2 examples. The first one is with a colleague, Dennis Lajeunesse, and he used to be a fruit fly specialist. And now he's specializing in the area of biomimetics, where we're looking at natural structures and trying to leverage, first understand what they do, and then try to create things that leverage those properties. And one of the things you'll encounter, and this impacts our P&T guidelines, when he came in, he had to reinvent himself. He had to reinvent himself from being a fruit fly researcher to a biomimeticist. It took about 4 or 5 years, and thank you for your patience there, but he's now securing significant grants in this area. One of the areas he's worked on are cicadas. I used to hate cicadas. And a couple of years ago, we had a cicada bloom here in North Carolina, and two of our first year students were out on their bikes, and they collected bugs and twigs and brought me back to my 3rd grade, but brought back these cicadas and put them under one of our high-powered microscopes. You notice how the wings are clear and sort of colorless? Under the scope, what you see is a sea of nanocones. So far we found 3 functions for those. They're super hydrophobic, so water can roll off of them so they can fly in rainstorms. The cones absorb a spectrum of light that its predators looking for to track them. So they're called, this is a family called obscurants. They can fly in stealth mode and hide from their predators. The most important attribute, though, is if you drop a bacterium on them, this might be a yeast, a bacteria will try to attach to the tips of those cones, but it's not sufficient, so they keep spreading out to attach to more and more of the surface until the surface tension is too great and they rupture. This is a new family of antimicrobials. Most antimicrobials are chemical, and bugs can develop resistance. They may develop resistance to these too, but it'll be much harder. And so we're studying this. So here he's totally reinvented himself in a very wonderful way, and now we're looking at, okay, so what is it about these cones? Can we modify the surface? What's the chemistry of the interaction between the bugs and these? So there's a lot of good fruit out there. Oh yeah, Cone Health, a hospital here, had their research conference at the joint school a couple years ago. And they challenged Dennis's group to come up with an artificial cicada wing surface. Because if you could coat a sink or a doorknob with this stuff, maybe you'd cut down on the transmission of bacteria. So this is the world's first artificial cicada wing. It does kill bacteria. We're not quite as good at killing fungi yet because they tend to roll and break off the tips to these things, but we're on the right path. Okay. So in my lab, I've been reinventing myself from being a nanoelectronics researcher to working in the area of hydroponics, which is where you're growing plants without soil. And we've done some fun things where we've added smart materials to the hydroponic feed stream and let the plants take up that material to create smart plants. So we're growing cotton and flax, for example. This is a flax plant. And I don't know if you noticed, but there's blue. Oh, here, that's a better image. It's a nice blue. So the plants take up what's called an optical brightener into the leaves. And our goal is if we can lock this brightener into plants and the textiles as they're growing, we wouldn't need to have it in our washing detergent because the stuff is going into our effluent all the time. It works. Our next step is to include nano sensors into the feed stream so that as the plant, let's say cotton is growing, you can weave a cotton sheet that is a smart sheet. And so if you're in a hospital, it can monitor your vitals, for example, passively, not have to wake you up at night. That's the goal. All right, so this is cool technology, but what if the stuff we're putting in there is damaging the environment? So I work with a colleague, Joe Graves, who's an evolutionary genomicist, to look at what is the effect of these additives on the microbiome. And here's a comparative growth curve. Let's see, the red one is where you're growing the plant without this optical brightener. The blue is where you've added the optical brightener. They're identical. So in this case, we're not hurting the plant. We're also looking at genetics. That study hasn't been done yet, completed. But if we were to find that the additive had an adverse effect on this nanotechnology, we would stop it and go in a different direction. We think that's the right way to go. All right. I think this is the last thing for research. Another thing that the nanoscience arena allows us to do is to go after non-traditional funding sources. And also the way the joint school is set up, it's fairly easy for us to work with our colleagues in industry. This is novel. One of the questions I was asked when I was about to be hired was, how would you feel if you didn't have your own lab space? We have a core lab model where the faculty serve as lab managers. And so we're in each other's labs all the time, we're sharing each other's equipment, and we're also there really to help students who have passed that qualifying exam. Once they've done that, they're conversant in all the disciplines, right? So we're there to help train them on whatever technology or tool they need in the joint school. So we value that. All right, switching to outreach. Just gonna, you can see the nano bus, which was donated a few years ago. We go out to K through 12 schools within a 2-hour radius of here, and the faculty are very supportive of this endeavor. So the shorter term educational outreach activity, one example is our Summer Science Academy. And we have different activities for 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th graders. Rising 9th graders will build their own hydroponic system. They design their own experiments. We give them some tools for basic statistics, and then they present on it. And they get it. They do a really good job. But the hands-on activities are what keep them coming back. In fact, one parent said, so what metrics are you looking at? And I said, I look at their eyes. And how many come back? Right. We're also collaborating with the School of Education on campus here, something called the T4 program, Transforming Teaching Through Technology. And our students have a teaching requirement, but we don't teach undergraduates at the JSNN. So we have every year 8 of our students spend 20 hours a week in one of the K-12 classrooms in the Guilford County area. So that's also supported by our faculty. Longer term, we're developing longer-term relationships with some schools in Western and Eastern North Carolina. We're also working with Forsyth Tech's program to teach, or to introduce teachers around the country into new ways of teaching that will fit into their core curriculum. Personally, the folks that have influenced me a lot are as I mentioned, Alan Alda and a woman named Trudy Ellian, who lived about half a mile down the street from us. And she did a lot of work in viruses. You know, before the 1980s, we didn't have many treatable conditions. And toward the end of her career, she would adopt 12 middle school girls every year. And she would give them her personal phone number, take them out to lunch twice a month, and to get them through that hot period of as middle school. That's the kind of long-term mentoring we're also encouraging our faculty to engage in. All right, I'm almost through here. And another version of community-engaged scholarship. So we've received some support from industry, and one company is called Applied Materials in California. They're the largest supplier to the electronics industry. There's an area of patterning, which is critical, called self-assembly. Today, the wires on a computer chip are about 30 nanometers. So it's about 150 atoms across. And that's about as small as we can get with a traditional approach to self-assembly. I mean, in our bodies, right, we have proteins, we have DNA, those are all self-assembled structures. So we're borrowing from those paradigms, but it's running out of steam. It's like walking along that path. They took a risk on us. They funded us to try different approaches, more biomimetic approaches. And recently, a colleague, Hamale Rathnayak, a new faculty in our department, and Kristen Dellinger, who's a postdoc, and I were able to create, these are 3 nanometer copper wires. Each of these dark lines is a different wire. And there's usually we have to put down markers on the surface for them to become parallel, otherwise it looks like spaghetti. Here they're organizing themselves naturally. 3 nanometer wires means 15 atoms across. These are probably the world's smallest copper wires. That's cool. And we think we understand what's happening. We're not sure, but so this is really a whole new playground for research. We can do it also with other metals like nickel, and we're in the process of now designing new precursors that are like biomolecules that will allow us to do this with other materials. So we really encourage this kind of research, and that's reflected in our guidelines. Final example is entrepreneurship and translational activities. Yes, we value publications. We also value patents. We value startups. We value media coverage. I'm just going to give you one example of how we pivoted. One of our students, Anthony Dellinger, was working on a drug delivery system to minimize the effects of chemotherapy. So we would only deliver the therapeutic agent to the cancer cells. It worked. In fact, what he did is he put the chemical inside this Trojan horse, and there was a molecule on the surface that would only attach to the cancer cell that would open up and kill it. So he wanted to start a company, and he applied for a Small Business Innovation Research Award to NIH. They turned him down twice. But he persevered, and story goes, they were fishing in Florida, and they were catching crabs, and one of his friends said, well, it's a shame we have to use all these forage fish to catch so few crabs. This is not sustainable. And a light bulb went on in his head. He said, you know, I can put anything I want to in this Trojan horse. So I could put a chemical for chemotherapy, or I could find a molecule that attracts crabs. It's called putrescine, and it smells. He did that and made then a sort of this time, little time-release capsule, nanocapsules, put them into a pellet that looked like a bar of soap, tied a string around it, went down to Wilmington, tossed it off the pier, and he has this video of all these blue claw crabs converging on it. So he said, start a business in this area. Right? He received $100,000 for a phase one award. He made about 10,000 of these pellets, gave them to fishermen up and down the East Coast. They loved it because it was more effective than the forage fish. It didn't stink. And it's much lighter. And the Fish and Wildlife Service loved it because it was truly sustainable. Two summers ago, he then received a Phase 2 award for $750,000. I think he's received about another $1.3 million to date. He has a small business called Organobait. So here you have somebody who's focused on pharmaceutics being able to pivot and see another market opportunity. And by the way, it's a $6.3 billion market. So he's doing well. What time? A few minutes? So we have other students who are in that mode. So we want to nurture, these are things we value. Because part of our charter also is to be an innovation engine for the region. There are just two stories. I'm only going to be able to show you part of one. One of my relatives in Pennsylvania, Hugh Herr, and in 1982, he had a climbing accident. That was his passion. And he lost both of his legs. Undaunted, he went to his garage and started designing special feet for those different difficult climbs. So if a crevasse was too narrow, he would, in his backpack, take a new foot out, put on, and away he'd go. He's now at MIT Media Labs, and his passion is to design prosthetics that restore natural gait to those in need. He gave a TED talk a few years ago. I'm just going to show you part of that.
Powerful Idea was a call to arms to advance technology for the elimination of my own disability and ultimately to the disability of others. I began by developing specialized limbs that allowed me to return to the vertical world of rock and ice climbing. I quickly realized that the artificial part of my body is malleable.
Okay. I'm gonna switch.
Over a 200-day research period, we studied...
Remember the Boston Marathon bombing?
Yeah.
Okay, so there was a young lady in that race who lost a leg to the bomb. He visited her in the hospital and said, you know, we can help her. And by the way, one of her passions was ballroom dancing. So he brought in dancers, model them, a great research project. He has this wonderful transdisciplinary team, and I just want to show you what happened and the value of transdisciplinary.
Dance. We brought in dancers with biological limbs, and we studied how do they move, what forces do they apply on the dance floor. We took those data and we put forth fundamental principles of dance, reflexive dance capability, and we embedded that intelligence into the bionic limb. Bionics is not only about making people stronger and faster. Our expression, our humanity, can be embedded into electromechanics. It was 3.5 seconds between the bomb blast and the Boston terrorist attack. In 3.5 seconds, the criminals and cowards took Adrian off the dance floor. In 200 days, we put her back. We will not be intimidated, brought down, diminished, conquered, or stopped by acts of violence. Ladies and gentlemen, please allow me to introduce Adrienne Hoslett Davis, her first performance since the attack. She's dancing with Christian Leitner.
Nanotechnology goes into that prosthetic, but it's transforming lives. The only one I'm just going to start, there's Amy Mullins. Has anybody heard of Amy? So she's been working with nanotechnologists to make composite materials to make prosthetics that are art. So I'll just do a minute on this. Sorry. coats off.
Explore. So I made a deal with the adults that
she's
the kids could come
classroom.
In without any adults for 2 minutes on their own. So the doors open, the kids descend on this table of legs, and they are poking and prodding, and they're wiggling toes, and they're trying to put their full weight on the sprinting leg to see what happens with that. And I said, kids, really quickly, I woke up this morning, I decided I wanted to be able to jump over a house. Nothing too big, 2 or 3 stories, but if you could think of any animal, any superhero, any cartoon character, anything you can dream up right now, what kind of legs would you build me? And immediately, a boy shouted, kangaroo! No, 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 it should be a frog. No, it should be Go-Go Gadget. No, 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 it should be The Incredibles and other things that I aren't familiar with. And then one 8-year-old said, hey, why wouldn't you want to fly too? And the whole room, including me, was like, yeah. And just like that, I went from being a woman that these kids would have been trained to see as disabled to somebody who had potential that their bodies didn't have yet. Somebody that might even be super abled.
All right. It goes on like that. So I'm going to finish up here. So this is the environment, the P&T environment we want to encourage at the joint school. Andrew, I really want to thank you. All the presenters this morning were wonderful, and I think we're developing this community. But I also want to thank that department for taking the risk of stepping off the path. Right. And this is a quote from a friend, colleague, now friend of mine, back in 96. In my former career, we started a Center for Environmentally Benign Manufacturing in Arizona. And at that time, if you thought about environmental technology, companies thought of it as a cost. Right? It turns out, I won't go into the story, but in terms of water recycling research for the electronics industry, students at Arizona put together a hokey recycling system that demonstrated was not only possible, but it was cheaper to recycle water than to buy it from the town. And a light bulb went on in the industry where being a good environmental steward was also good for the bottom line. Today, 97% of all water in the industry is recycled and saving companies about $10 million a year per factory. It was transformative. Today, I say mostly these companies see environmental technology as a competitive tool. So it says, let not what you do define what you are. Rather, let what you want to become define what you do. So I think you are moving the P&T guidelines in that direction. So thank you very much.
Questions for Daniel. And Daniel, if you could repeat the questions.
Sure.
Will you share your PowerPoint?
Of course, yeah. Can I give them to you? Well, they're on your computer here.
We'll mount them on the website afterwards. Okay. Along with these, we're recording the sessions as well.
Thank you. And by the way, how many of you have visited the joint school? Okay, so there's a lot of opportunity. So those of you who haven't, if you're coming in from out of town, stop by. We love giving tours. If you're in Carolina, we love giving tours to kids, to families. We really firmly believe that this in community engaged scholarship and CU as partners. Yeah?
So it seems like a relatively new school, I guess.
Yeah.
Developing the P&T guidelines is something you probably weren't bound to a long tradition of, but everyone comes from a tradition wherever they're from. How did you?
Yeah, so we actually first did our P&T guidelines in 2013. We went through that process and it didn't fit. It didn't fit. And so especially, you know, we want to be transparent. We want to bridge with other departments. And the only way to do that is to support that through the guidelines. So the things that we value that we weren't achieving, we added those to the guidelines. And we're probably still not perfect. So it's going to be a living document for a while. Thank you. That's a good question. Other questions? Are you hungry? All right, let's do mock lunch.